one funny thing. I organized this timetable, the schedule, like a kind of match, and like a kind of match. So every time, every two slots are Hungarian-Russian, Hungarian-Russian. It's somehow funny. So the second talk, where is Maxim? Ah. It's even more funny. Didn't see you. The second talk is by representative of Russia, of MIPT. This is Maxim Zhukovskii.
My talk is about subgraph isomorphism and induced subgraph isomorphism problems. Well, it is maybe more of interest for specialists in model theory. However, the results have some motivation, some logarithmic motivation, so it is also interesting for specialists in electronics. First of all, I will remind some definitions. I think that everybody, most of you know them. However, let me say that I'm speaking about first order language of graphs. So first order sentences in this language are built of these symbols. So first two are relational symbols. For the first one is for adjacency of two vertices, and the second one is for the equality. Logical connectivity is variables and quantifiers. So variables is for vertices of graph. So on next slides, I will give some examples. But first, let me give some additional notations. I will write in this way when I want to say that the sentence phi is true for the graph G. Or I will say that the graph G models the sentence phi. So sentence is a particular case of formula. Maybe sometimes I write formula, but I always mean sentence. A sentence means that the formula is closed. I want to say that first order property is the set of graphs which is defined by some first order formula phi. It means that the graph is in the set if and only if it, this graph models this sentence. I also need the definition of quantifier depths of a sentence and variable depths of a sentence. Quantifier depths means that you have a sentence, and you have in this sentence you have sequences of nested quantifiers. So you can build a forest of nested quantifiers, and then quantifier depths of a sentence is the length of the longest path in this forest, which starts from a root. So, for example, maybe it can be such forest, such tree. It will be forest if you have conjunction or disjunction of different formula. If you have, in the beginning you have no conjunctions, if it starts from the quantifier for all, then you, for example, can have this forest, and then its quantifier depth is 5. Because the longest path is P5. Okay. Here I have an example of formula of a sentence, which is given here, and the quantifier depth of the sentence is 4, because you have sequence of 4 nested quantifiers. But variable width is 3, because variable width is the number of different variables, and you have appearances of the same variable are not account. For example, you have variable x, which is 2 times here, and you count it only once. So what does this formula represent? What property does it define? Well, there exists x such that there exists y such that x, y are adjacent, and there exists z such that z is adjacent to y, and there is no edge between x and z. And also there is a vertex x. Well, why can I use the same variable x? Because when I use it in the second time, I don't need the first one. There is no connection between the second x and the first x. So I can use this x and forget about the first one. So there exists x, which is adjacent to Z. Why this X and that X cannot be the same? Because the first one is not adjacent to Z, and the second one is adjacent to Z. So variable width of this sentence is less than its quantified depth. This sentence defines a property of containing U4 such that one of its endpoints for, let me say, the first vertex is not adjacent to the third one. Well, if you consider the property of containing U4 and without this additional property that there is no edge between the first one and the third vertex, can we define it using, for example, using formula with quantified at 3 or with variable width 3? Or we only can do it using 4 quantifiers and 4 variables? So this is a question. Before I answer this question, let me give some examples of first order formula which express some usual graph properties. For example, a property of a graph to be complete can be defined by this formula. This formula has quantified depth 2 and its variable width is also 2. The second example is the property of a graph to contain a triangle, and this sentence has quantified depth 3 and its variable width also equals 3. Here are examples of three properties which cannot be defined in this language. They can be defined only in second order language: the property of a graph to have chromatic number k, property of a graph to be complete, and property of a graph to have even number of vertices. It's not so simple to understand why these properties cannot be expressed in the first order language, but this result has some combinatorial proof, and it is a common result for specialists in model theory, and of course it means that the natural question is, okay, let some property be defined in first order language. Then what is the minimal quantifier there? So if we consider the smaller language where we have only k quantifiers, can we express this formula, this property in this language or not? Okay. So the first question is for some graph isomorphism, as for P4. Can we define P4 using three quantifiers or using three variables? Here I denote by D of S the minimal quantifier depth of a sentence which defines the property S, and W of S is the minimal variable width of a sentence which defines the property S. It's not difficult to prove that W of S is not greater than D of S, as we see it for the property on the previous slide. And I want to consider the properties of containing subgraph. So for example, if you have some pattern graph F, it is fixed and it has L vertices, then let me say that S of F is the property of containing isomorphic copy of F, so it is the set of all graphs which contain F. Isomorphic copy of F, not induced, any copy of F. The problem is to find D of F and W of F, where D of F is D of S of F, so it's minimal quantifier depth of a sentence which defines the property S of F, and W of F is the minimal variable width of a sentence which defines the property of containing F. And of course, trivial upper bound is that D of F is not greater than L, because you easily can use L quantifiers to define this formula. You just need to say there exists x1, there exists x2, there exists xl such that all these vertices are distinct, are pairwise distinct, and you just need to say that some of them are adjacent, and then you will say that there is a copy of F. It is easy to prove that in fact they equal to L. So for any F, G of F and W of F equals L. This is because no first order sentence of quantifier depths or variable means it doesn't matter. Less than L cannot distinguish between the complete graph on L minus one vertices and the complete graph on L vertices. So But the complete graph on L vertices contains any subgraph on L vertices. And the complete graph on L minus 1 vertices doesn't contain. So the answer is simple. But for the induced subgraph, isomorphism is not so simple. So let me give the same definitions. So here I use another type of brackets. S of F is again the set of all graphs containing an induced isomorphic copy of F. Here it is, the copy is induced. And the same definitions of D of F and W of F, and the same trivial bound that W of F greater and D of F is also not greater than L. And the question is it true that for any graph F, these two parameters are the same? And the answer is no, it's not true. And the most simple example is the Poe graph. Poe is triangle with an additional edge. So it's a graph of four vertices with four edges. Alario in 1988 proved that the graph, that an arbitrary graph is Poe-free. Poe-free means there is no induced Poe. If and only if each connected component of this graph is either it doesn't contain a triangle or it's complete multipartite. And using this result, we can construct a formula which has quantified depth 3 and which has variable depths also 3, which defines this property. This is the formula. So it says that there exists x1, such that there exists triangle containing x1. So this is the first row. Then for the same vertex x1, there exists a vertex x2, such that it is not adjacent to x1, and there is a common neighbor of x1 and x2. And also there is a vertex x3 which is adjacent to x1, but which is not adjacent to x2. What does it mean? So if our graph has an induced Poe, it is very easy to see that this formula is true. But if there is no induced Poe, we can use the result of Alario, and we know that each connected component of H either contains triangle, either it doesn't contain triangle, or it is complete multipartite. So the component which contains X1 it contains triangle because we know it from this sentence. But in this case, it cannot be complete multipartite because of the second part of the sentence. Okay. Well, as I have already said, these problems have they are quite natural for specialists in model theory, but they also have an algorithmic motivation. Of course, so we can consider the problem of recognizing our property. So we want to understand, does our input graph G contains H or not? So as a induced subgraph or as not a induced subgraph. And of course this problem can be easily solved in time big O of n to the power L if you use an exhaustive search. But there are better results. The first one here on my slide is the result of Nestriel and Pollack, and it was proved in 1985 that both problems can be recognized in time big O of n to this power, which is less than L, where omega is some constant of fast square matrix multiplication. In 1995, Alon and others proved that S of F for not induced subgraph problem can be recognized in this time where TW is 3 bits of F. So if a graph have small 3 bits, so on next slide I will define 3 bits if somebody don't know what it is. But now let me just believe what I say. So if some graph have small 3 bits, for example, cycle or tree, then we have this time bound. So in this time bound, if we have small trivets, then n to some constant power, which doesn't depend on the number of vertices. Okay. There is also the result that says that the subgraph isomorphism problem for KL is unsolvable in time L to the power small o of L unless the exponential time hypothesis fails. So if one can prove that there exists for KL, there exists an algorithm which solves this problem in time n to the power small o of L, then this hypothesis fails. So this is a very interesting problem. And one more with motivation is the theorem of Corsell of 1990. He proved that each graph property definable in monadic second order language can be efficiently decided on graphs with bounded trivials. So, for example, what does it mean for our problem of subgraph isomorphism? Sorry. So, if as subgraph isomorphism is defined in first order language, it is also defined in second order, in monadic second order, it doesn't matter. By this theorem, we have this time bound for input graphs with constant trivials. So here TW is trivials of the input graph tree. So here we have n to the first power. Well, why these results motivate us to consider the definitions of subgraph isomorphism in first order language? Because if we have a formula which defines the property of containing subgraph F, we can just check this formula. If it is true, then we have graph F in our input graph. And what is the time bound for this algorithm if we know quantified depths or variable widths of such a sentence? Of course, it is n to the power, well, variable widths or quantified depths. Variable widths is better. So if we prove that we have bound n to variable widths, where variable widths is less than in the result of Nestrel and Pollack, then we have a better result. We have a better algorithm. So it would be very surprising if we have such a result, because this algorithm is, it just uses two relations, the relation of adjacency and the relation of the equality. The last result of Corsell motivates us to consider the graphs of arbitrary large trivials, because for arbitrary input graph, we know that the quantified depth equals the variable widths equals the number of vertices, so it is not interesting. It is interesting to consider the graphs which have some properties, for example, that the graphs which trivials can be arbitrary large. For such sequences or graphs, the theorem of Corsell doesn't work. So it is interesting to understand what is the minimal quantified depth in this case and the minimal variable width. So we will consider three classes of input of parameters of graph for our input graph for the problem of subgraph isomorphism. Sufficiently large connected graphs, the graphs with sufficiently large trivials, and graphs with sufficiently large connectivity. Well, it's maybe natural generalization of the previous case. So let me first of all remind the definitions of connectivity and large trivials. So consider a graph on at least k plus 1 vertices. We say that it is k connected if it is connected and remains connected after removal of any of its k minus 1 vertices. And the connectivity of a graph is the maximal k such that the graph is k connected. Well, and trivials, so this is a definition from Wikipedia, and the picture is also from Wikipedia. And a 3D composition of graph, so to define trivials, we need to define 3D composition. 3D composition of graph is a tree which has some set of vertices, let me denote them by x1, xn, where each x is subset of vertices of our graph. And the union of these sets is the set of all vertices of graph G. This is the first condition. The second condition is that if a vertex of our graph is inside two sets, say Vi, Vj, then for the unique path xi to xj in all the vertices of our tree, there is this vertex inside this set. And the third condition is that for every edge of our graph G, there exists a vertex of the tree T such that there are these two vertices of the set of this edge into the set. Well, and the width of the 3D composition is the maximum over all sizes of all its vertices minus one. And the tree width of graph is the minimal width over all the 3D compositions of graph sheet. So for example, for this graph, we have such a 3D composition and it has minimal tree width. It has minimal width, so the tree width is 2. Okay, so now how we define our relaxations for subgraph of this morphism problem. So we consider input graphs we have sufficiently large value of some parameter, say parameter pi. It can be the number of vertices for connected graphs, it can be the tree width, or it can be the connectivity. So consider some graph parameter pi, and we say that d pi k of f is the minimum quantifier depth of a sentence which defines the graphs which contain f over connected graphs with this parameter, this parameter. Well, it is easy to see that if d pi k is not less than d pi k plus 1, so this sequence decreases. So, and we can define the limit of the sequence as minimum over all k, d pi of k. And this is, of course, the minimal. What does it mean? It is just the minimum quantifier depth of a sentence which defines S of f over all subgraphs, over all graphs, input graphs with sufficiently large parameter pi. And the same definition for W pi of f, which is variable width. Well, so it is simple to prove that this inequality holds. This inequality holds. So the inequality tree width is less than the number of vertices. It's simple. The second is not so simple, but it is still true. And these inequalities imply that we have the following relations between our parameters. So the biggest one is for the number of vertices, and the smallest one is for the connectivity. In order to state our results, I need to define these three classes of graphs. The first one is lollipop graph, the second one is sparkler graph, and the third one is megastar. So what is a lollipop graph? It has two indexes, the first one A and the second one B. So on this picture, A equals 4 and B equals 2. So we have a complete graph on A vertices, KA, and we have a path on B vertices, PB. And we just connect by an edge one vertex of the complete graph with the endpoint of the path, and we get the lollipop graph. So in the same way, we get a sparkler graph, but in the top, we do not have the complete graph, we have the star graph. And the megastar is It also has two parameters. The first parameter is say A, and the second one is B. A equals 3 on this picture and B equals 2. So we consider a star with A leaves. And we subdivide each edge of the star into BB plus 1. And we get this megastar graph. Well, the sparkler graph STT gives us the best upper bound that we know, so the smallest upper bound of DB. So we cannot get smaller than L minus 3, where L is the number of vertices. So for STT, we have this upper bound, for T at most 4. And the lower bound for all graphs F is for the quantifier depth is L plus 1 divided by 2. And for the variable width is L minus 1 divided by 2. So for example, for STT, we have T as its lower bound and 2T minus 3 as its upper bound. And it is, it is difficult problem to understand which bound is true. Okay. As for input graphs with large trivets or connectivity, we can get arbitrary small parameters, the quantified x and the variable width. So we can consider the lollipop graph L of AB, and so its trivets is A minus 1, which is easy to see that it's A minus 1, and its parameters, all the parameters dw, w to w, and the same for the connectivity equals A for this graph. So we can so this means that we have arbitrary large graph which has the values of these parameters A. However, this doesn't give us any interesting results for algorithms, because the result of Elon gives us n to 2 trivets, and here we have n to 2 trivets plus 1. Well, the lower bound is, so the first result is sharp because we have this lower bound, it is that these parameters are at most 2 trivets plus 1. Unless f is contained in some 3 megastar m3b. So why for the subgraphs of 3 megastar we have the value of these parameters equals 1? It is because of the grid minus theorem. So from the grid minus theorem it follows that any graph with sufficiently large trivets contains the megastar m3b. And we also have such nice result in terms of the number of edges of graph F and the number of vertices of graph F, which shows us that the d kappa of F is at most E of F divided by P of F plus 2. Well, I don't know why I put here the same result for W kappa. It is quite the same, but not plus 2, plus 1. And the results for small graphs, so here I consider all connected small graphs with 3 vertices and 4 vertices, and we have the complete picture here. So the interesting part of this table is that for the only graphs for which W is less than D is in case of the parameter V, the number of vertices, it is the graphs P4, the path graph on 4 vertices, and the star is 3 leaves. And the results for some sequences of graphs. So if you consider the lollipop graph LAB, so then we have DV equals L minus 1, WV equals L minus 2. So in particular, if you consider a path graph, it gives L minus 1 in case of the quantified depths, L minus 2 in the case of the variable widths. So for the star graph, we have this result. And, well, very nice result is that if the minimal degree of the graph is at most 2, then dv equals wv equals l. So this is why, for example, if you consider simple cycles or the complete graph, so for these graphs we have the answer l. And the sequences for the input graphs with large trivets or large connectivity, as I have already said, for lollipop graph we have this result, and it is easy to see that for arbitrary forest we have d kappa equals w kappa equals 1. It is because if the graph is k connected, its minimal degree is at least k. This means that if k is very large, we have any forest inside this graph. Well, and it is also not easy to prove that for KL we have again L, the answer L. So it is true even for arbitrary large connectivity. Well, what are the open questions here? So before I will say about the induced subgraph of isomorphism, let me say what are the open questions for the subgraph of isomorphism. So, well, the first question is this bound tight? So we know that dv of f is greater than the number of vertices divided by 2, but we cannot disprove even that it is greater or equal to v minus small 1. particular, it is interesting what is the exact value of dv of the exact value of dv of STT. Well, and okay, of course, the mentioned algorithmic result motivate our interest of lower bounds of W kappa of F. It can be shown that D kappa of CL is at least logarithm of L base 3. But for WK, it is not so simple. We even cannot disprove is it bigger of 1. But if it is bigger of 1, then we have a good algorithmic result. Okay. Our lower bound of W trivets of F implies that the respective algorithm cannot be better than the algorithm of L. However, it is also interesting to obtain these parameters for CL. Okay. Now, induced subgraph isomorphism. So we proved this general result. So for every graph F on L vertices, W of F. So the minimal variable width of the sentence, which expresses the property of containing the graph F, is at most hermetic number of maximum between the hermetic number of F and this expression where L is. For the small graphs, we have this theory. If we consider only graphs on three vertices, then we have the answer L. If we consider the graphs on four, then the only connected graph on four vertices for which D and W are not equal to L is the Poe graph. And for all the other connected graphs, it equals L. Well, what are the open questions here? So first of all, we have these results for the Poe graph. Are there other such graphs for which these parameters are less than the number of vertices? And of course, it is interesting, are there infinitely many such graphs? The lower bound, which is given on this slide, which we proved, doesn't exclude the possibility that the algorithm which is based on first order sentences can be better than the algorithm of Nesbitt or Boolean with this exponent, because L over 2 is less than L of omega over 3. In particular, we can consider graphs on 5 vertices. So we have no results for graphs on 5 vertices. But if there exists graph on 5 vertices such that it's minimal, the minimal quantifier depths for this graph and the minimal variable width for this graph is less than 5, for example it is 4, it is already better than the result of Nesbitt and Boolean, because it is gives exponent n.373, and but there are also some results which give better bounds, but just in some cases. So maybe if we prove that there exists graph for which we have the parameter equals 3, then it is better than all these results. But even if it equals 4, maybe it is better than result than these results, but for some other graphs. And on the last slides, I want to give the proof of the fact that the minimal variable width of a sentence defining the property of containing induced subgraph isomorphic to F is at most hermetic number of F. Well, just because I think this proof is very beautiful and rather simple. First of all, let me define the case extension axiom, and I will denote it by EK. What does it mean? It is the sentence of quantifier depth K saying that any two sets which are disjoint, such that the union has cardinality less than k, for any such two sets, there exists a vertex z which is adjacent to all the vertices from x and which is not adjacent to all the vertices from y. So on this picture, we have two sets with cardinalities. Some of these cardinalities, their cardinalities is less than k, so there exists a vertex z which is adjacent to all the vertices and x and not adjacent to all the vertices. vertices y. Well, it is a well-known fact that if we have two graphs which models this case extension axiom, then there is no sentence of variable width less than or equal to k that distinguishes between these two graphs. So if we consider any sentence with variable width at most k, then either this sentence is true for both graphs or it is false for both graphs. So it is not difficult to see this distinction. Well, then let me say that k equals the geometric number of f. F is our fixed pattern graph, minus 1. From the previous slide, it is easy to see that to prove our theorem, it is sufficient to construct two graphs, G and H, such that the first one contains F as an induced subgraph, and the second one doesn't contain F as an induced subgraph. But both graphs have, model the case extension axiom. So if both graphs model case extension axiom, it means that there is no sentence of variable width at most k that distinguishes these two graphs. But if first one has graph f, the second one doesn't have graph f, it means that the minimal variable width of a sentence which can distinguish these two graphs is at most k plus 1, so at most the geometric number. So we just need to construct these two graphs. And we will construct them using the probabilistic method. It is also well known that if we consider the random graph in the Bernoulli model with the probability, with any constant probability p, for example p equals 1/2, then asymptotically, almost surely, it has an induced copy of f if you fix any pattern graph f. And it is also has, for any fixed s, it has s extension axiom. And the second, it means that we have our graph G. So we just take our random graph as asymptotically, almost surely it has this property, so such a graph exists. So we construct our graph G. Now we want to construct a graph H such that there is no induced subgraph which is isomorphic to F and which has K extension axiom. So we can consider that complete multipartite graph with k parts and with n vertices in each part. And we can consider the random subgraph of this graph. So choose each edge of this graph with probability 1/2, or remove each edge of the complete graph with probability 1/2. It is not difficult to see that this graph also has k extension axiom. So this is because if we have k parts, if we fix k minus 1 vertices, there exists at most one part in which there is no of these vertices. So there are a lot of edges from each of these vertices in this part to the remaining vertices. So it is easy to see that there is asymptotically, almost surely there exists this random graph models the case extension axiom. But the hermetic number of this k is less than or equal to k, because the hermetic number of this Turan graph equals k. If you consider its random subgraph, it is less than or equal to k. And the hermetic number of our graph is greater, because k is its hermetic number minus 1. And so we get our result, because if the hermetic number of the graph is less than k, it cannot contain any induced subgraph which hermetic number is k. And this is the end of the proof and the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
As usual, any questions, comments? No questions? No comments? Okay, so the first two talks are finished. Let us thank both speakers again.